Wipfli, you know, who we are. We are a mid-sized regional firm, about 1,100 people firm-wide. We have 22 offices here in the United States, mainly based in Minnesota, Illinois, and Wisconsin. We have one office up in Washington State, and we have two offices in India that handle some software consulting. You know, a traditional accounting firm, services, audit, tax, and we have quite a different variety of consulting services available that kind of comes with a firm our size. So let's rewind the time, rewind the clock back about a month and think about where we were, and I'm not sure if anyone else was as sick of hearing the term the fiscal cliff as I was, but it seems like we couldn't go anywhere without hearing that. So what we were kind of facing for 2012 was that plenty of credits that had been available in prior years had expired. There was this looming individual issue for many taxpayers called the alternative minimum tax. And what the problem with that is it hasn't been indexed for inflation. It's been extended for 25 years, but hadn't been addressed for 2012 yet. And various accelerated depreciation methods that had been available in 2010 and 11 at pretty high levels were not available in 2012 to the extent that they were. So going into 2013, what were we looking for? We're looking for at higher tax rates for pretty much every individual taxpayer with the 10% bracket going away. Again, no alternative minimum tax patch, payroll tax holiday, which ended, and even more restrictive depreciation rules, which comes into play here. So what we got was the American Taxpayer Relief Act of 2012 that was signed into law in 2013. And just to summarize for, you know, for individuals, it was a bill that was heavily weighted towards individual tax. Marginal tax rates for most individuals were made permanent, so the tax rates that were available in 2012 were made permanent for 2013 and beyond, but in tax, there's really no such thing as permanent. It's really permanent until the next bill gets passed. The alternative minimum tax patch was enacted, so it was indexed for inflation and had made quote-unquote permanent. Certain investment tax rates were kept at 15%. State income tax exemptions were made permanent and indexed for inflation, and then various credits were extended. Now for businesses, what was kind of interesting was bonus depreciation was put into effect for, or extended, I should say, through 2013, and Section 179 depreciation expense limit was increased for 2012 and 2013. So what was kind of interesting in my world is we were going through all these planning discussions at the end of the year, do we buy equipment, you know, it's kind of the traditional discussion that you have, and you know, we got to the end of December and we still had this Section 179 depreciation limit of $139,000. January 2nd, 2013 comes and they've offered $150,000. Thanks. You know, the thing with going, what was interesting about this last December is that, you know, you have a lot of these planning discussions and, you know, we had much more, in my world, we had much more than in previous worlds because people were really interested in what's going to happen. Well, we know what the law was going to go, but we knew that law was not going to happen. So, you know, we could have a discussion saying that, you know, this is what it's going to be, but we know that's not what it's going to be. And then what we're here to talk about today is that there were some energy credits extended. Nothing was really new, but credits that had expired at the end of 2011 were extended through 2013 and in one case 2014. So we'll start out by talking about the income tax credit, the alternative fuel vehicle refueling property credit, section 30C. And this is a general business credit. I mentioned that because that'll come into play in a little bit here. So what qualifies here? The property cannot be a building or structural component. It must be depreciable property. There is a caveat in here that personal, you could have installed a piece of this equipment at your personal residence. credits are much smaller, but can be, it is available. It has to be new property, so the original use has to be with the person that's claiming the credit. And I had to quote this just because it gives an example of kind of the way that the IRS puts these qualifications in. But it's essentially, it's for the storage or dispensing of fuel into the fuel tank of a motor vehicle. It also includes electricity, so charging stations is covered by this credit. It has to be primarily used in the United States, and it must be placed into service by the end of this year, 2013, or in the case of hydrogen refueling, 2014. What's kind of interesting about this is you hear it's a two-year extender. Well, it's not put into place until 1 year into the extension period. So, again, IRS in action. So what fits into the definition of alternative fuel? CNG and LNG fits into this. It also includes mixtures of fuel, electricity. And the credit is 30% of the cost of the property. However, it's limited, it's capped at $30,000 for the property, but it's the $30,000 is based on the location. So it's $30,000 a location. If you, for instance, you have a company that has several locations that's installing these units, it's $30,000 per location. IRS isn't really specific in defining a location, but in general, it's, you know, a place of trade or business, and it's going to be dependent on your facts and circumstances. The $1,000 credit for non-depreciable property is if you were to put it in at your personal residence. More of an incentive to be done in places of business. And the credit is not allowed for any of the portion that's expensed under this section 179. So just as an example, say you have a $100,000 piece of equipment. Credit can be 30% of that or $30,000. You have a $150,000 piece of equipment. Credit's gonna be $30,000. Then what it also does is the amount of the credit reduces the amount that's available for depreciation. So going back to that $100,000 piece of equipment, you're only allowed to depreciate $70,000. Now, if you were to say, well, I want to take that $70,000 and expense it under 179, that doesn't work the way the credit calculation works. Because what it's going to do is it's going to take that $100,000, reduce it by $70,000, now your credit is based on 30% of $30,000. So the other thing that this act did is it reinstated bonus depreciation. So going back to that $100,000, you have $100,000 piece of equipment. Take a $30,000 credit, you have $70,000 of depreciable property. You can take 50% of that $70,000 as a first year expense, and then depreciate the rest under normal rules. So if you kind of apply the general planning tax rate of say 35%, you know, if you're just to deduct that entire $100,000 under section 179, you get about a $35,000 tax benefit. If you're to take advantage of the credit and then take advantage of bonus depreciation, your tax benefit is bumped up to about $45,000. Now, one of the special rules under this is you can elect not to take it. Well, using those numbers that I just used, why wouldn't you take it? Well, because it's a general business credit, you cannot use it to offset alternative minimum tax liability. And so if you're a taxpayer that's constantly plagued with paying this alternative minimum tax, you're really stuck having to carry that credit forward until you're not paying alternative minimum tax. So in that case, you know, kind of a time value of money may be more beneficial just to not take the credit and to expense the property. If you do stop using it for trade or business uses, it is subject to recapture, so if you were to start using it for personal purposes, you might have to pick that money back up. So that's the main income tax credit that was extended. The other credit here that we're going to talk about is the excise tax credit. And John referred to this, referenced this a little bit earlier, but it's essentially a 50% per gallon equivalent credit for excise taxes that's paid on alternative fuels. So this credit is really made available to the sellers of, say, CNG and LNG. It's also available to the users of CNG and LNG if it's, say, your privately owned facility. So if you were to, one of the qualifications is you have to be registered with the IRS to pay the excise tax, so that will reduce 18.3% per gallon equivalent, or 18.3 cents per gallon equivalent, and then you're eligible to get a 50 cent credit to offset that. What's nice about this is that it is refundable. It's first taken as a reduction of your overall excise tax credit liability. So if you're selling a mix of different fuels, you know, you're paying excise tax quarterly, this credit first reduces your liability that you have on a quarterly basis. And if it's in excess of that liability, then it's a refundable credit. It was extended for 2 years, so it's again related to fuel that's sold or used by December 31st, 2013. Do we have any blenders out in the audience? Okay. Well, the blenders were misbehaving, and the alternative fuel mixture excise tax credit was also extended, but what they changed for 2012 and 2013 is they made this credit non-refundable. So it can only be used to offset any sort of excise tax liability. The main reason is there were many erroneous claims in the past. So really what this credit, this excise tax credit, is for anyone that's doing the fuel blending. Same fuels qualify for this credit. It's under the same time frame of has to be fuel sold or used by December 31st, 2013. Actually, let me go back. I wanted to make one distinction about this. The fuel vehicle refueling property credit. So it's for property that's used to dispense or store alternative fuels. So, you know, in general, if you're just putting in a storage tank, say you're a fuel wholesaler, put in a storage tank that's used to, you know, hold alternative fuels, you fill your tankers and you take it out to different fueling stations. That's not qualified property. Now, if you were to put in a dispensing unit that actually filled the trucks that went to go take that fuel to the retail stations, then it can be considered qualified property. So there's kind of some certain caveats around this. You have to look at your facts and circumstances, and you want to really work with someone when you're analyzing the economic cost of this, is to make sure that you know that you do qualify for this credit. Okay, so getting back to the excise tax credits, how do you claim these things? Well, it's first used, or it's calculated on Schedule C of Form 720. So this is the quarterly excise tax form that you file. You can claim it on Form 4136, which is filed with your annual income tax return. The income tax credit that I mentioned is also, that's claimed on your income tax return. It's calculated on Form 8911. And just to kind of help speed things up here, so just this isn't anything new either, but the excise tax exemption rules, you know, exempt. There's certain activities that are exempt from excise taxes. Where I see it the most is in farming and off-highway use, so that's, say, manufacturing companies or